Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, dogs, cats, Budgie sitting in the corner, welcome along to our 2020 Children's First Foundation Gala Ball, COVID style. 2 years ago, this young lady won our hearts at the Park Hyatt. She is here with us in the studio to open our event. And by the way of magic, we can hear you clapping in the background. So please cheer loudly, whistle loud, stamp your feet, do whatever you like. And please welcome Amalia.
Wish I could have said goodbye. I would have said what I wanted to. Maybe even cried for you. If I knew it would be the last time, I would have broke my heart in two. Trying to save a part of you. Don't wanna feel another touch. Don't wanna start another fire. Don't wanna know another kiss. Know the name falling off my lips. Don't wanna give my heart away to another stranger.
Malia, we better not do that. Yes, we better not do that. So, we are all COVID safe here, and very well done. That was, they've paid like $150 for these beautiful hampers. You've just covered that by about 10 times. Thank you so much. Will you come back later?
Of course.
Excellent. Thank you so much. Thank you. Well done. Everyone's clapping at home, please. Clap at home. That's fantastic. Now then, we have got for you this, we've got to kickstart this event, and we are going to throw to the acknowledgement of our country.
We acknowledge the traditional owners of country throughout Australia and recognise their continuing connection to land, waters and culture.
We pay our respect to their elders, past, present and emerging.
Fantastic. Excellent. Thank you so much, kids. Now, we're grateful to have the CEO here, Liz. Thank you for joining us. And what's happening at Children's First up there now? What's going on?
Well, all the kids are in their ball gowns and Coco's in his black tie.
Excellent.
Inspired by your good self. And they're all enjoying the ball from the retreat where the children are pre and post surgery. So they're very excited.
They are dressed up.
They are dressed up.
Like the folks are at home, which
That's
is great.
That's exactly right. All of you out there as well.
Excellent. And now, so the COVID's given us all challenges, hair, everything. So I'm starting a 70s band, it's okay. What is, how has it changed for you guys?
Yeah, it's tough for all of us, isn't it, this year? But our two biggest challenges have been the borders closed because we can't bring the children in, and someone like Coco, we just can't get him home at the moment, which is really hard because he wants to be home for Christmas with his family like we all do. And then the operating theatres, of course, have been closed, understandably. But now they're reopening. That's fantastic. We can start getting some more children through. But the kids up at the retreat, all our kids, they face challenges every single day. So we take our inspiration from them. We've got seven up at the retreat at the moment, as I said, in different stages of their journey with us. Coco is ready to go home, and Rachel's almost ready to go near the end of her rehab. And then we've got Sonia, who you've just met. Sonia and Alona need one final surgery. Then they're going home, hopefully, which is fantastic. Nicole, we've just had some fantastic news that Nicole's surgery will be coming up in the next few weeks, we hope. So that's huge. We're just so excited for Nicole. And then Christina and Kyla Joy, we're still just waiting to get confirmation from them. So it's all happy, healthy, and they're amazing. They're just a true inspiration.
So you said up at the retreat. How does the retreat work for these kids?
So when the children arrive in Australia, they commence at the retreat in Kilmore. It could be due to medical tests required, blood tests, meeting surgeons. They might need a little bit of extra nourishment, for example, and just for them to feel comfortable and safe. And then they have their surgery, and then they return back to the retreat up at Kilmore. It's just one big, huge family home. It's a beautiful place to be for them.
And how many staff do you have up there?
There's always at least one staff member on, and then we just love our volunteers. Yeah. So
fantastic.
Team effort.
So one of our goals tonight is to get Coco home. So, but how much does it cost, roughly? I don't want you to give me exact figures, but when a child says, "I need help," and can you do it? End to end, what's that sort of cost?
Approximately $60,000. That's if the child stays for 6 months.
Yep.
And there's no extraordinary expenses. So that's just bottom rate. So, for example, the need is just as strong now, even though we can't get the kids here. So we've got 11 children at the moment who have been approved for surgery. So 11 times 60.
Yep.
Plus we've got 9 in the review stage with our hospitals and our surgeons. And then there are so many more in the pipeline with Marina. So about $60,000 per child per 6 months is how it works.
Now, every year we sort of give ourselves a challenge at these things, as we do. And tonight, should we just make for now? And we reserve the right to change things, as other people do. Let's just go for one in and out, 60 grand tonight. Let's see how we go. Because we haven't got them here for me to shake upside down. But hopefully you out there will get shaken upside down, and that will all be good. So how many people do we lose every year that just can't get help?
Well, the frightening statistic is that 17 million people across the world have a surgically preventable condition. 17 million. So one child tonight is going to make a massive difference for that child, for the child's family, for the village they live in. So we're just one child at a time. We're going to crack that 17 million one day as hopefully a global community. So where you're born should not determine your access to medical care.
Yeah.
And that's really sad. So we redress that inequality at Children First Foundation, and we think every child has the right to access excellent medical and surgical care. So that's why we're all here tonight, to get more kids here and to get beautiful Coco. We love Coco to bits, by the way. It sounds like we're trying to get rid of him, doesn't it?
No.
But Coco was in hospital last year for Christmas, and like all of us, we want to be with our family on Christmas Day.
Nima and Dawa were back in the paper this morning. I couldn't believe it, in the Herald Sun.
Oh, gosh, I didn't see that.
Yeah, they were in the Herald Sun this morning.
Oh, that was meant to be, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah, absolutely meant to be. Now, we are in the studios of RPPV, and we must thank them very much, but we are on a shoestring simply because of COVID. So we have Steve, who is our producer, Steve Myers, out there. He is running from, you won't see him, folks, but he's like a chicken that's not well, and he's running everywhere. We've got lots of help. We've got Luke here on the cameras. We've got Tamara coming up with the cheese. We've got Amy over here, who's going to look after us with all the things that are going on, which is why I wanted to throw to Amy in a second, because where are we up to already with our fundraising tonight?
Well, thanks to the enormous generosity of everyone out there and who's backed us in this virtual ball, we, as they say in Australia, we're giving it a crack. So thank you out there. Up on your screen at home, the Virtual Gala Ball fundraising platform, you'll see a wonderful sum that's currently sitting at $16,000. So that's a straight net profit we're at the moment. We're only just kicking off, and we've already raised $16,000. And then a lot of our friends couldn't be with us tonight for a number of reasons. So we've received an extra $15,000 in donations in lieu of ticket sales, etc. So 15 plus 16 at the very beginning, we're at 31 grand. So thank you very much, everybody.
We're halfway. To one.
To one, that's right.
We reserve the right to change it to two or three or whatever we can get to. It's just fantastic.
Yeah.
So thank you, Liz, and I'm sure we'll talk to you a little bit later on.
Yep, terrific.
I've got to go through some housekeeping.
Okay, do that. See you all later. Thank you.
Hopefully you've seen all the wonderful cheeses here that you have at home, and hopefully you haven't. What we'd like you to do, though, because I know when we do one of these live, the more alcohol, and please drink responsibly, that you drink, the more you spend. So we'd like you to continue with that this evening if you could. So the first course we'll be coming up with, we need you to drink that bottle of wine very quickly, because we want to get all three in 2 hours, sort of. But please drink responsibly. So as many of you in this new world that we've got, COVID's all around, and we have to do things like in here. So I'm just going to explain a few things to you. You must register via the link that you've been sent to donate. If you try and buy things and you aren't registered yet, then you'll just get sent to the Children First Gala website and you register there. So that's all fine. You must register, though, to be able to bid on these wonderful items over here. And we've got some fantastic stuff. I can see Woodlands Golf is already there at $550 and $300 for tomorrow. Well, $300. That means I've been outbid. I don't like that. That's not a good thing. Anyway, it's going to be very hard for me to bid from here too. So you can see the bids next to the items as you go through. You can do that. You can see, as we are seeing here. Can you show them that on the screen, Luke? Just there you go. That's what you need to see. So you will receive a message when you have been outbid. So when someone outbids you, you will receive a message and go, darn it, have another glass of wine and put another bid in. You also have an option to say, okay, I really want to go to Port Douglas. Don't we all want to go to Port Douglas? Yes, boy, do we want to go to Port Douglas anytime soon. And Amy, what are we up to?
Port Douglas now is up to 3,300.
And that place is out. Let me tell you, it is outstanding. It is ridiculous. I have stayed there. And you've got your own bedroom, you've got your own spas, you've got your own plunge pool, you've got everything, so you need to go crazy. But let's just say you really want to do that. You can put in a bid of 5,000 right now and just relax for the rest of the night, or 10,000 just to make sure you secure it. Now, we won't spend all of your money. It's until people keep going up and up and up and up and up, and we get to your limit, then you will get someone to tell you that you are now outbid. So that's that. You can remain anonymous, as you can see up there. So we've got anonymous bidding on Dalesford. Nobody wants to know who's going. We've got Sarah, they're going on the long table, but you don't have to give your name, whatever you like. The auction closes at 6:35. 6:35, the auction closes. We have no control over it here. It will just close down. Even if we're running late, it will just close down. Your credit card details are encrypted. I have no idea what encrypted means. But it doesn't matter. So on the site, your security will not be, nothing's going to happen. We're not going to keep it, so it won't be stored. Donations will remain open after the auction. So once you've been after the auction, then that's all good. Troubleshooting. If you've got issues with it at home and it's not working and it's just driving you crazy, events@galafundraising.com.au. So events@galafundraising.com.au if you have any issues. Right, so we need to introduce our, we don't need to introduce our winery visitor. The next video is, the kids are coming up now. The kids are coming up. The kids are back in town. Here they go. Here they go, somewhere, they're coming.
2020 has been a difficult year for many people. And we have all faced unexpected challenges which have tested each of us in different ways. At Children's First Foundation, we know all about challenges, and we face them every day. The best way we know how, together.
We know that the challenges makes us stronger, that they teach us how to deal with the tough times and appreciate the good ones.
We know if we can face them bravely and with determination.
With the help from
that we can achieve anything.
That we can make our dreams come true.
How amazing are our children. Their courage and positivity inspire us every day, and their smiles melt our hearts. Coco, you are spot on. You can achieve anything. And Nicole and the other children at the retreat, your hopes and your dreams can be achieved. Dreams that will be fulfilled when you return home to your families and your friends and your villages. And Christina, you've got lots of new friends tonight. Friends who have joined us for this evening's virtual gala ball. Friends who believe in you. Together, we are committed to help all of you guys at the retreat and all the children who are waiting to come to Australia for life-changing surgery, to achieve your anythings, to achieve your hopes, and to achieve your dreams. Thank you for your friendship, and thank you for sharing your lives with us tonight. Children out there who need our help and the help of the Australian community, and together we can achieve something quite extraordinary.
Okay. Wow. Very moving. My little mate Jack was there, and boy, does he look different today. Goodness me. So now we will take a look at our video coming up very shortly, but our donations are going up. We're 16,416, which is absolutely brilliant. So we're going up all the time. So jump on that website, keep drinking, and all is good. And we have got the video coming up very shortly because we are, poor Steve's running around like this going crazy, but it's all good. We've got the video coming up shortly of the winery, and then we will have Tamara in. We've got Stephen coming up on the phone and linking up via technology. And here we go with the video. Clapping at home, which is wonderful. So 3RW each week.
A long time ago now, but yes.
Yes, well, you were there. Grape Expectations. It was one of my favourite titles for a show.
It was a great title for a wine show.
Exactly, yeah, exactly. And you've got a cooking school?
I have a cooking school many years ago in Hawthorne called Tamara's Kitchen. And then I had a stint living overseas, came back and moved to the Mornington Peninsula, became a cheesemaker, and then have just recently restarted the cooking school to expand from the cheesemaking classes that I've been doing for a while to the COVID star, which is sourdough bread, and everyone wants to know how to really make sourdough bread. So I've introduced a sourdough masterclass, which is booking well, and that'll probably lead into other classes as time goes by and we're allowed to sort of gather in groups again.
Yeah, so I'm trying to go to the sourdough, but
you've been
people keep outbidding me, which I don't like, but we may chat about that later. You are the original owner of the Boat Shed.
I am. So yeah. I started Boat Shed Cheese as a way of dealing with the grief after losing my 14-year-old son in a scuba diving accident. And Reagan's favourite food was cheese. And when I made cheese, I felt like he was close by. So I made lots of it. And if anyone's ever made cheese before, they know that it's a bit like chicken soup. You don't make a single serve, you make a batch.
Yep.
And so I had lots and lots of cheese to get rid of and was giving it away periodically. And then people started asking it and wanting to buy it. And that's how Boat Shed Cheese was born. And it was originally made in a boat shed on our property, which is where the name comes from.
Excellent.
So that's its little brief history.
Brilliant. Now, we're going to have a little chat with Stephen very shortly. So I'll just give you a bit of Stephen's background, our winemaker. So what a life he had. He grew up in a winery with a wine family. Imagine going out to play and say, I'm going to go and play...
In the vines.
In the vines, with the wines. So his family founded Mitchelton Wines in 1969, and Stephen brought his wines in 1989, the Shelmerdine brand. He's got a hands-on approach with everything that he does, so you know, he's out there looking at everything, and he's here, hopefully, via the wonderful world of Zoom technology.
Oh, there he is.
We have found him. Stephen, maybe we just turn him off and we'll talk about the cheese and wine for a minute and we'll try and get it later. Oh, he's trying to find every angle. So let's chat about the cheese.
So we've got a selection of cheese and we're going to serve the goat cheese. We're hoping that you are going to have your goat cheese with Stephen's Merindoc. So I'll just open that. It's a Viognier. Perhaps you'd... actually, I can
I'll come round and pour that.
So the first cheese that you have today is Oasis, which is the green covered goat cheese. It's a fresh goat cheese, and so it's made by a lactic method of cheese making, which results in a cheese that is particularly young and light and fresh, and it's coated with dried chives, which rehydrate from the moisture in the cheese. So you should have this fantastic moussey texture. If I just cut it open and you have a look at that, you should be able to see this lovely moussey white cheese with the green coating, and it's particularly lovely with a crisp white wine, which is why Stephen's paired it with the Viognier. So let's try the wine, and I'll perhaps give you some cheese, John.
Okay,
you can see how it works. Whoops.
Hopefully you're all doing this at home.
A little bit better than us.
Smells nice. Oh, very nice.
It's very nice.
Mm.
And that really, really lovely crisp white long finish is fantastic with the goat's cheese, because what you really don't want with wine and cheese is for one to fight with the other. So you need a cheese that's short and fresh and light with a wine that is also light, so that neither one fights. And it's quite interesting, if you try the wine first, and for those of you at home, I suspect you've actually been trying the wine for a little while.
Yes.
Then try the cheese, and then try the wine and cheese together, and you'll find that the wine tastes very different once you've had the cheese in your mouth.
Okay, let's do that.
So try the cheese. Hopefully you like it. It's really fresh and light, and it's also fantastic, if you don't finish it all tonight, fantastic crumbled over a roasted vegetable salad, fantastic over pizza, or just spread on crackers as we're doing tonight. What do you think?
So you shouldn't eat crackers and try and talk.
Well, that's right. I'll just carry it while you swallow for a bit. So this particular cheese is best served when it's about a week old, and the cheese that you have is 5 days old. So it was made at the end of last week, and then we packed it on Tuesday in its hampers and sent it out to you. Most of you got your hampers on Wednesday or Thursday. So your cheese is really at its peak now and will be lovely for at least another week.
Another week?
Another week.
Fantastic.
But it's a fresh cheese. So, you know, a little bit like... cottage cheese, you wouldn't sort of keep it for months on end like you might for a blue cheese, which we'll talk about later. But it really is at its peak when it's young and fresh and moussey like this. And because it's a lactic cheese, it's never going to become an older, mature cheese. It's just going to get sour like yogurt would that's too old, and it won't be pleasant. So you want to eat it and enjoy it while it's young.
How long, I know they all have their use-by dates when you go into whichever store you go into to buy your cheese. How long would it these cheeses last normally in your fridge?
So we chose this selection because it gives you a really good cross-section of both milks and styles. So this is goat and it's fresh, so it should be eaten within about 10 days to 2 weeks. The Brie has a shelf life of about 8 weeks, but it's at its peak at 6 weeks.
Okay.
And when we try that shortly, you'll actually see that the Brie is already starting to run out of its rind a little bit, which is at the perfect temperature. So hopefully at home, you've had your Brie out for at least an hour, maybe even longer, and it's starting to soften. So a Brie that's got no preservatives at 8 weeks is starting to get a little bit old and past its best. Although, if you're French, you think that's the best time to eat it. So when I've had my farmers markets over the last 10 years or so, in Australia, we have to sell our cheese when it's at its peak at a discount, because we can't hold it for another week or two.
Yeah, yeah.
And if we don't sell it on Saturday or Sunday at a market, we're unlikely to sell it. And so I get all these people that speak French coming up and chatting to each other in French and saying, oh, those Australians, don't they realise that it should be the most expensive when it's at its best, not discounted? And I speak French, so of course I'd always answer them in French, and they'd sort of be quite sort of put in their place that somebody heard what they said. But the reality is that the French are used to buying cheese on the day to eat on the day. Australians tend to follow the American system, which is to stock up your fridge for the next few weeks when you might impulsively want to eat cheese.
Sure.
And that's not the best way to buy cheese. The best way to buy it is when you want it, because hopefully your cheese maker or your cheese seller knows when it's at its best, and you can say, I'm looking for a Brie for today or tomorrow, and buy one that's perfectly ripe, rather than trying to buy one that is 2 weeks away from perfectly ripe and filling that sort of time frame and getting it right, which is much harder to do.
So just for our viewers, I nearly said listeners because we're normally in here doing radio, just for our viewers, How long is the ideal time to have them out of the fridge without them oozing all over your plate?
Well, I want them to. I actually like them to ooze. Okay. As far as for a cheesemaker, that's the sort of the pinnacle.
Right.
Oozing for a brie anyway, or for a soft cheese.
Yeah.
But a good hour, because what you really want is for the cheese to be at an ambient room temperature of about 22 degrees. You don't want a fridge cold cheese. So these have been out a little over an hour, I should say, and under studio lights. So they're a little warmer than they perhaps should be, but they'll be delicious.
Yes.
But hopefully you've taken your cheese out at least an hour before. And if you have a brie, these ones are perfectly ripe. We made sure of that. But if you have a brie that's a little bit underripe and you want to eat it tomorrow, leave it out for 24 hours and it will ripen quickly. People in Australia freak out when you say, leave it out of the fridge for 24 hours, because they're thinking, oh, it's dairy and it's high risk. But the cheese has matured. We've actually made it go off, if you like, when we made it. So it can't go off. It's just a question of its maturity. So the warmer it is, the faster it matures. So I always say to people, if you've bought a brie that's on the young side and you want to eat it this weekend, leave it out overnight and you'll find amazing things happen. And tomorrow it will be oozing.
And totally different summer to winter.
Totally different.
Yeah.
Yeah, totally different. And summer milk to winter milk too.
Yeah.
So the animals that are milked in summer have different proteins and fats than animals that are milked in winter. And the cheese reflects that. So people do need in Australia to sort of try and think more in the seasons. And we as consumers need to stop wanting all of our food standardised and processed. And we shouldn't be buying strawberries in the middle of winter. We should be waiting for them in summer when they're at their peak. And cheese is the same. A washed rind is at its best in winter. It's not very good at all in summer.
Yep.
So we need to try and educate our consumers to sort of eat within the seasons.
Tomorrow, can you come back for a second course?
I'd be delighted.
That would be fantastic. Steve, are we right to go to our keynote speaker? I think we are. We're good to go to the keynote speaker? Yes, and we need to have a quick chat. Oh, my goodness.
Look, it's going up really fast, which is really exciting. 17,546 so far, but we're still looking for somebody to bid on the Ken Duncan photography at $2,000.
So you need that. Get in
folks
there,
need
to
please.
Get on that. And that's plus the 15 that isn't included.
That's
so
right.
We're nearly at 33, so we're over halfway, Liz, which is great. So that's wonderful. Now, our keynote speaker this evening is an orthopaedic surgeon with special interest in lower limbs, joint replacements, deformity correction, and secondary post-traumatic reconstruction. Last year, he operated for Children First Foundation on seven-year-old Chien from Vietnam. Chien had never taken a step prior to the operation. He's the director of orthopaedic service at Monash Health. He's an adjunct professor at Monash University and president of the Osteo and Trauma Care Foundation in the South Pacific. As well as assisting CFF, he also provides training for orthopaedic surgeons in hospitals in Ho Chi Minh City. Please make him welcome Professor Ton Tran.
Good afternoon, or rather good evening. Welcome all to the annual gala ball delivered first time in virtual space. I'd like to thank Marina and the Children First Foundation for the opportunity to be a keynote speaker tonight. I do hope that you'll all dig deep and contribute to the organisation to continue to carry out its most worthy cause.
2019 was the first year of my formal engagement with the organisation, and being shown the most magnificent work that has been achieved by the organisation over the previous decade was the most humbling experience for me. Tonight, I'm hoping to take this opportunity to take you on a few journeys of my own that have led me to becoming part of this body. Like a lot of Australians, I've come to embrace our country, a land of opportunities and acceptances, a land which has given me and countless other people across the world a safe haven to rebuild their lives. I was indeed born in Vietnam, a country much smaller than Australia, with four times more people. It is a country scarred by millennium of wars, but has emerged with new strengths. Its heritage and natural beauties, coupled with its people, have never failed to leave a lasting impression in its visitors. And if you've never been, I would strongly recommend that you consider doing so at the end of this pandemic. Among this background, I'd like to share with you the journey of two different people over two different time periods. I was the older boy, and I was born in Saigon, or Ho Chi Minh City, as it is now known. I lived a pretty sheltered life in a city in a country that was ravaged by war. With the fall of the South, the end of the war triggered the biggest human exodus of boat people in the Southeast Asian history. Between 1975 and 1980, at the peak of the exodus, countless human lives were lost at sea in a search for new life. We were among the more fortunate ones, when our trip only encountered two near sinkings, and after 7 months in various refugee camps, we arrived on a very cold August morning in 1979 to our new home. We received nothing but support, and with no English or money, we launched full steam ahead into our efforts to rebuild our lives. Australian value was taken on, maybe sometimes a little bit too well. Our life continued to roll on endlessly, and busy surgical career subsequently, however, led me to a size trip to Ho Chi Minh City in 2014, a trip that completed my return journey to my birth country exactly 35 years on. My impression of a country, even as our plane approached the international airport, was the immense life force emanating from the thousands of bike headlights dodging and weaving, sharing the finite amount of road space below, turning off on a four-lane highway into 10 to 20 lane of motorcycles. The hospital that we had been engaged in would not be a better place to demonstrate this sharing spirit. With its reputation being the best orthopedic hospital in the country, it carried a very heavy burden of care, yet every patient seemed to serenely share the space that came available. Family members assisted not in just the care of their own, but also their neighbours. And like the heavy traffic outside with its chaotic order, mutual respect is shown in an environment where one would not expect such to exist. All resources are put to good use, yet some of the most humbling work and workload were there to see. Among this chaos, however, one found accountability and integrity in the work, in the crispy white uniform to the nurses, and in the smiling faces of the doctors, even as they slept three to a bunk on their cool nights. Education, as one would guess, in an Asian culture is greatly valued and thirsted for. Delivering it, however, has been a challenge for all of us over the years that we've been engaged. If you can imagine standing under two heat lamps in a 37 degrees heat with 100% humidity, surrounding by 30 observers while wearing a raincoat, that will be the experience that we've been through. What surprised us the most was that respect and recognition of contribution to the education extended beyond the living. We found that everyone of all ranks, upon entering the dissection room, would be required and in fact expected to light an incense stick to pay homage to the donors who have volunteered their bodies to further their education. During our travel, we are in fact even luckier to meet the most dedicated and the most beautiful soul. She runs the biggest orphanage in the city of 10 million people. She was the only medical personnel there, assisted by two physiotherapists, one of which is blind, 10 nurses, including three volunteering nuns. Together they looked after 200 outpatients and 380 highly complex inpatients. All were done and delivered with integrity and love based on about 70 Australian dollars per child per month, all inclusive. Not wanting to be just another foreign team on a personal self-gratification trip, and with due consultation and acceptance, we form a team and partner with the facility. Over the last 5 years, we have managed to establish great rapport and friendship with the local team. We've been able to make infrastructural changes as well as medical assistance to help with the children's care.
I wanted to give time and care to those in need.
I wanted an opportunity to make a contribution.
Walking into the first rooms with the children was very difficult. It was something I hadn't seen before.
I've never done anything like this before.
To be honest with you, this is probably one of the best things that I have done. Watching these kids, it's about what's happening right now, and there's a beauty in that.
To be able to be trusted to pick one of these children up and take them outside, literally putting their life in your hands is a really big deal.
When we brought the bubbles out for the first time, there was instant joy.
Placed him in my arms and he was out of his bed. He lit up and he started laughing and making these little gurgling sounds in the back of his throat.
I can take the kids for a walk, carry them around, dance with them, and that frees up more time for the other carers to look after the other kids.
There's such great perspective here on how life is different.
These kids are incredible, so, yeah.
In 2019, recognised the need to further assist in the care and management, as well as early intervention of the neuromuscular children, we launched a cerebral palsy project. We were able to pull together teams for more major pediatrics and obstetric services in the city, where we share our knowledge and assist in the care of the children. Most important of all, this and despite the pandemic, with ongoing engagement during this year, we've now been able to make further inroads into this project, and we've now been able to engage and be an integral part of the Cerebral Palsy Family Association of Vietnam, a big step forward in the management and the destigmatization of this country, of this condition. While I was doing my work, another soul arrived on the scene. I met Tien last year. He was born 7 years ago in a poor village in the far north of Vietnam, a city of spectacular scenery and just as beautiful people. Being regarded disabled, he was abandoned by his parents and spent his time getting around in any way that he could. When time to go to school, he was carried on the back of his best friend for most of the year. Fortunately, he was spotted by an angel from Norway whose sister happened to have a condition similar to him. She reached out to the world via the power of social media and the world stood up, with volunteers coming from various parts of the world, including a local team. Distance was overcome, especially given that Vietnam owns the fastest and most reliable 5G network that I've come across during my global travel. The extraction process of this child, however, was no small feat. It required an army of volunteers to bring him from the mountain literally to the end of the road with a road stop, taking that first flight to Hanoi, staying at the Foster family, and eventually making his way down to Ho Chi Minh City. Very, very kind-hearted group of Australians just managed to launch the facility where it was expected to assist greatly in the care and assistance of family with children with this condition traveling to the big city for care and recovery. The subsequent trip was even further for the young man. He encountered people of all shapes and sizes in the country, of people sharing one simple goal: to help children from across the world. The human spirit was revived very rapidly within the month that he was with us, and he took his journey home after 30 days, walking on the feet they have not touched the ground for the previous 7 years. During my journey with Tien, I've learned that human spirits cannot be quelled, even in the deepest, darkest of adversities. I've learned that all you need is love, a big genuine heart, and a big smile to match. I learned that even in poverty and limited resources, love, respect, and humanity will keep us all going through the hard time. After 2 years, Tien has finally come home, and so have I. To paraphrase a famous person, while we might not be able to change the world, we can certainly change a part of the world that we live in, starting with even one soul, including the person that you see every day in your own mirror. Thank you again for your wonderful past, present, and ongoing support of this wonderful organization. And for those of you who, like I was a few years ago, standing alone on the sideline watching, I hope that someday, maybe today, maybe tomorrow, that you will all join us and the world will be as one.
Thank you and good night.
And back to me. We have... See, we need to compare us to the Brownlow that's going to happen Monday night.
We're going to be funnier.
We have got poor Stephen. I think he's going to have a heart attack. But it's all good. Thank you. And you can make a difference to this with what Professor Tran does. We need your funds to help us. Amy, we're nearly at
20,000. Come on, we just need a couple hundred more to get to 20.
We do. Well, yes, that will get us to 20. That will give us like 35. So we need to get a lot more bidding, a lot more raffles, and we need you to buy more tickets in the raffle. The $3,000 bracelet, oh my goodness. And we'll be talking to Rachel very shortly. Rachel's coming up. Here she comes. Poor connection. Excellent. It will happen very shortly. So just before we get Rachel, second prize in the raffle is, this is a photo of a little boy, and Rachel sketches. So she has made that sketch, and that is second prize in the raffle. So you can see how good that is. You need to buy more raffle tickets, folks, because this is absolutely brilliant, and There's the photo. There's the young chap. So there you go. That's all that. Now, Amy, while they're still looking over there to try and get Rachel, which is all good, can we have a look at a few more auction items?
Well, we have to remember the Zoot prize. You can
the
talk.
The Zoot prize, yes.
$400 so far on that.
Oh, that's too cheap.
It's very cheap.
That is way too... Has anyone heard of Rick Springfield or B. Birtles or Russell Morris? Let's face it. I mean, you're going to meet these guys backstage and the drummer. So you're going to meet these guys backstage, watch their show. It's awesome. It's good. And we have found the kids. Yes. Excellent. Rachel, are you there? Rachel has... Here she comes. This.
Yeah.
How are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
Excellent. And you're all dressed up, all of you?
Yeah, they all look pretty.
Okay, can you tell us who's there? Who have you got with you? Yes, she can. No. Yep.
Can you tell the turtle?
The turtle right now is 4,936.
Okay, that's good. And we've got poor connection again, but it's okay. We'll fix this. This is fine. This is just because we're talking to them up at the retreat and the reception there is not great. But are you with us again, Rachel?
You still there?
Yeah, maybe.
I'm still here.
You're here. Oh, good. Did you like the singing at the start? Because we've got her coming back to do another song.
Yes.
Excellent. Can you show us your dress? Maybe that's just too hard. We will get there, folks. Don't you worry. Oh, there we go. Beautiful.
Thank you.
Coco, show us your outfit, mate.
Stand up,
Coco. Look at him go. Well done. Sonia, can you show us your outfit, Sonia?
Hi.
This is like the Melbourne Cup. If only we were going to that. Here we go. Excellent. Well done, kids. We will come back to you a little bit later on. So stay tuned. We will come back to you with some more things a little bit later. And we probably should find Amalia.
And in the meantime, $5,000 has just been donated for a night in ICU.
Oh, nice. Well
yep,
done,
we're up to,
guys.
We're up to $25,000.
Well done. That's fantastic. Absolutely brilliant.
Yay.
$5,000 just jumped in. So our total is going up. So that is all good. Now, we're going to do something fun. Can we go to the donations page, please, Amy, where it says make a donation? Yep. So on the donation page up there, you can see the $150 a day care. A day of care costs $150. So that's up there now. Now, the first three people to click on that and give us $150 each, obviously, will receive a $100 Priceline voucher each. So you're actually buying that for $50. You're actually going to get something for it. So this is just bang, bang, bang. First three get three vouchers for $100. Now, we promised you that she would be back, and she is back. And Amalia, what are you singing? Okay, beautiful. Okay, beautiful song from Amalia. And please make her welcome. We'll clap in the studio.
I'm not afraid to die.
Okay, let's get you back over here. No, just grab that mic there. Awesome. So that was just unbelievable, and
thank you,
and I'm sure everybody out there was having a ball. What are you up to?
What am I up to?
Yeah, what are you doing these days?
I can't say much, just at home, but I am
the rest
studying.
Of us, yes.
Yeah, I am studying at uni, yep. And I am working on my upcoming EP coming out soon. I can't tell you the date or anything, but I am in the process of recording originals and I'm loving it, absolutely loving it.
Are you writing?
I am.
This is going to be so exciting. We all remember you on TV when you were 14.
Yes.
Turning 15, and now you're driving a car.
I am.
I know, you grew up too quickly. But folks, wait for that, because Amali is unbelievable. You are going to be a star.
Thank you so much
for joining us tonight.
No, it's been an honour. It's been a real honour.
You're wonderful. Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay, now we have to have a look what is next. We've just done the retreat, and we have had Amalia. So let's get Tamara back. See, now, on Monday night, Gil McLaughlin can't do this. There's no way known he'll be able to take his bow tie undone, because it's very warm in this studio, let me tell you. It's boiling. But now we've got our next course. Hopefully... Oh, Stephen! Nearly.
Yes.
Yes! Fantastic. He's on a jog.
Is that better?
There you go. Perfect.
Hello. Good evening.
Welcome. Oh, no, you're back. Have you got us?
I can see you both. Yeah.
Excellent. Perfect. Well done. Now, can you have a chat about our second... We'll just let you go now, and you have a chat about our second course wine, which is...
Sangiovese.
Yes.
Fantastic. Well, firstly, this is a magnificent event. We're very proud to be part of this. And our Heathcote Vineyards at Toubrac, where the Viognier comes from, is just down the road from Kilmore East, where the retreat is. So we've had a great pleasure in learning about the wonderful work that is done there. And to think the children are growing up and getting better in central Victoria is very moving for us. We've been growing grapes at Toubrac for the last 30 plus years. But as you said earlier, John, our wine journey started over 50 years ago, Mitchelton, and we've been in the Yarra Valley. And now we've got two vineyards in Heathcote. So the first wine you had was Viognier, and I think you described it beautifully with the cheese. It was great. It's a lovely match, very complimentary. An unusual variety of Viognier. We think it goes very well with cheese. Now this wine, the Sangiovese, I just happen to have a bottle here myself. And you've got lots of grass for that. This is grown, you would have seen from the earlier clip, on the red soil of northern Heathcote. The Viognier is growing on granite soils at the south. Now, Sangiovese is the great variety of Tuscany, of course, the number one variety of central Italy, but now grows very well along with many other Italian, Spanish, and Portuguese varieties. In Heathcote. Heathcote, of course, is well known for Shiraz, but there are now these new wines coming from the great climate and soils of North Heathcote. So this is the wine that Tamara and I think goes very well with the next cheese, and it's medium bodied. It's got a lovely sort of sour cherry character with lovely tannins. It's fresh, it's bright. It's a little unusual to go with something like this lovely Brie, but it actually brings out some lovely nuances of flavour in the Brie itself. This is a 2018 wine, so it's just coming into its third year. This wine is hand-picked and fermented in oak, but not given too much oak, because we don't want the oak to overwhelm the purity and the vibrancy of the fruit itself. And Sangiovese will never quite the intense dark colours of say, Shiraz, because the tannin structure, the anthocyanin pigments in the skin are darker in Shiraz than in Sangiovese. But for those of us who love Italy and have been to Florence and Lucca, and this is the wine that you would be drinking on a summer's day in central Italy. So I hope you enjoy it.
Excellent. Now, Tamara, the cheese that you have chosen for us. Oh, thank you. Thank you.
So the cheese that we've matched with the Sangiovese is a Brie, but it's not just any Brie. It's a Jersey cow's milk Brie. So you can see that the colour of our cheese as it's oozing out of the rind is quite golden. And it's a particularly beautiful, oozy, succulent cheese. And hopefully you've had yours out of the fridge for long enough so that it is really oozy. And if I just break it apart, you should get this fantastic sort of long ooze. That's what you want with a perfectly ripe cheese. Now, John, that's your taste. I'm just going to pop that over here for you. Just going to put that there so that you can have a taste of it. So this cheese is about 6 weeks old, and it's got a white mold rind, which is very typical of a Brie. And I should actually just talk a little bit about the names Brie and Camembert, because like wine a few years ago, the French are starting to kick up a fuss about us using names for our cheese that relate to regions in France. And so the name Brie and the name Camembert are actually regions in France. So by rights, we shouldn't be calling our cheese Brie or Camembert. And we were advised 3 or 4 years ago, cheesemakers in Australia, to call our Brie's bloomy rinded soft cheese. Well, I'm sorry, a bloomy rinded soft cheese doesn't sound alluring. We know what a Brie is, so until we're legally not allowed to, we continue to call our cheeses Brie and Camembert because that's what people know. And hopefully with that particular cheese, you'll have a lovely match between the flavour and the aroma of the Sangiovese and the richness of the Brie. They work very well together. And like before, I think it's a really good idea if you taste the wine, separately taste the cheese, and then have them together. And you'll find that they bring out different nuances and different aromatics in both of them. And probably this is a good time also just briefly to talk just about Boat Shed. So you referred to me as the person that started Boat Shed Cheese, which of course is true, and it was my business until just about 3 months ago. I'd started realising maybe about a year ago that it was starting to get a bit much for me. It's quite a physical job making cheese, and I'm not as young as I used to be. And I put it to my children that one of them might like to take over the business, and they all just looked at me like I wasn't even speaking English. So it became apparent that I needed to put it out to the market, and I was very lucky to find this gorgeous family, the Archard family, who are dairy farmers in Victoria, and who were actually at a class learning to make cheese when they expressed an interest in the business. And a few short months later, they took ownership of Boat Shed Cheese at the end of June, and they're doing a fantastic job of following the same recipes and styles that we've become well known for and won lots of awards for, but they're also creating their own new versions of cheeses and their own new styles, which I think is fantastic. And what I wanted to see was Boat Shed in the hands of a family with the same sort of love and respect for making local produce. And, you know, if that's what I've achieved by handing over that business, then I think that's a very good thing.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Now, I see some paste in the middle.
Yeah, so quince paste. I make this quince and chilli paste for, well, I've always made it for my business and for our food service clients, and now I'm making it for Boat Shed Cheese. It's very good with the Brie, but it really comes alive with the blue cheese later. So when we have our third course, our bubbles and blue, that's the time that the quince paste really just lightens up the palate, because what happens is you've got the salt from the blue cheese and the sugar hit from the quince paste, and the combination is beautiful. And then the bubbles just helps to wash all that richness away. So it's a really nice combination. You've got that to look forward to. I'm sure people at home have already had some quince paste with their Brie, and that's fine, but try and keep just a little bit for the blue cheese.
And this is delightful. Oh, my goodness. We need, Stephen, send down, wherever you are, Stephen, send down 6 more bottles, please. That would be great, but drink responsibly.
Well, I must say, this is one of my favourite wines. I love a Sangiovese, and I normally don't like a red wine with a Brie, but this combination is beautiful, and I think it really does, as Stephen said, pair very, very well.
Extremely well. Thank you, Stephen.
Pleasure.
Now, we'll be back with these guys a little bit later, but just before you go, Lisa Barron has, she's just done everything in fashion in Australia and overseas. She's had gowns at the Oscars. I can't believe it. So she's had gowns worn at the Oscars. Everyone buys her clothes, especially women's suits and things like that, plus ball gowns that we will all be wearing, you will all be wearing next year, hopefully at the Grand Hyatt or the Park Hyatt or wherever we're going to be, and maybe we'll still be doing it here at RLP Studios. Who knows?
And she's the most beautiful girl to boot. Yeah. She might make beautiful clothes, but she's just such a delightful lady.
So what we've decided to do, we're going to get Amy to go back to that make a donation page, please, Amy. And what we have, we've got the first, number one, keeping the wheels turning. So keeping the wheels turning, you need to push that twice and you will receive a $150 voucher from Lisa to go and spend on her clothes, whatever you like. So all we need is click that twice and you will receive, the first person to do it will receive that. Now, Amy, you showed me something before as well that was very exciting. 30,000, and in the make a donation page we had something very exciting, which was 5,000 so far, and here we go down, maybe, yes, there we go. So that's 5,000 raised so far. That number seven, we need you to get back on that as well. If you want to give us $5,000, that's wonderful, to change your life. So that's terrific, and that's Lisa for us. Now we're going to go to our video.
The boat shed video.
Boat shed video, yes.
So this will show our listeners how cheese is actually made.
Love it. Love it. That was so cute, nice, and but great information as well.
And I think the thing with cheese is there's a lot of allure about making cheese, but most people don't realise how simple it is to make. And in fact, it's been made for thousands of years, so it can't be that hard because they didn't have thermomixers and all sorts of things in those days. And what that video shows you is just with a little bit of nous and a little bit of know-how, you can turn milk into cheese very easily. That's how I started. And that's why I do the cheese and bread making classes, because you know people want to know what they're eating. And so you know, if you like that and you want to learn how to make cheese, well, you just have to go to the website. And I think we might actually add another prize that you can use a little bit later. So just keep in your back pocket a gift voucher for a cheese making class. And people can go to boatshedcheesemaking.com and have a look at the dates, and the lucky winner of that prize can pick a date that suits them.
So do they come for
A whole day? They come for a day. So we make cheese and also bread, not sourdough bread, but just normal bread.
Yep.
And they have a day interspersed with a lovely lunch with wine and a very extensive cheese making, a cheese tasting, I should say. And they make in the class the French brie, this one that's oozing all over the bench.
Is it what?
The goat cheese and a ricotta. And then they take their new baby cheese home with them to mature over the next few weeks.
Oh. So, excuse me, Liz, how are we going for time? Are we okay?
Very well.
So can you please tell us, because we want to get the sourdough up to a lot of money. So just tell us, what does that entail, that sourdough class?
So the sourdough class is, well, sourdough is actually the mother, the natural yeast that is used to make sourdough bread. So these days, most people add instant yeast or freeze-dried yeast to their bread. But in the old days, we didn't have that. And so bread was risen by a natural yeast that you produce from mixing flour with water, and usually water that's had some fruit soaking in it so that you get those organics. So in the class, everyone gets their own little starter to take home. And during the course of the class, we feed it and watch it rise just as the class is going on. They'll notice that their sourdough starters are starting to rise. And we go through the process of making sourdough bread from scratch. It's normally a 24 to 36 hour process.
Yeah.
But I have six lots of dough at every step of the way to show them what's happening at this stage and this stage. We also make sourdough baguettes and sourdough croissants. They have a lovely lunch with all of the bread that we've made, as well as an overnight proved focaccia. And then when they go home full of that lovely bread and all of the things they've had for lunch, they take their baby starter and a folder full of recipes and tips and guidelines so that they can start their sourdough journey. And when they get home, the first thing they'll do is feed that starter, and then the next day they'll be ready to bake the bread they saw baked the day before.
For one person?
For one person.
Right.
Yeah.
Can we have a look? Where is it up to? It's only $500. Goodness me. Mrs. S, come on. I need you to bid on this. So that's fantastic. So,
and I think you know, one of the things that this period of isolation has geared us towards, a lot of those old skills, jam making, wine making, salami, sourdough,
so
cheese. And sourdough has been the star. And we've had so many people over the last few months that have booked into classes, and we were ready to start those sourdough classes in July. And then, of course, the second lockdown came and they've now all been pushed back. So we're very much hoping that Dan Andrews is on our side tomorrow and releases us enough so that we can start classes on the 6th of November, which is the plan. And then we can sort of get everyone through making cheese, making sourdough bread, going back to those old skills that bring so much joy to people and the people that, you know, in your family that you love to feed.
And you can take your sourdough to the golf course and have a hit. Hopefully, Mr. Andrews, tomorrow.
Maybe. Well,
you won't
be able to go to the clubhouse.
No one wants to go to the clubhouse.
We just want to go to
the pro shop. Come and have a hit. So we're definitely going to take those with some beautiful cheese.
Awesome.
Well, not in the sourdough. I'm interested about the croissant just before we go to our main award.
So the sourdough croissant sounds like something that is a new thing. But in fact, in France, if you go to a bakery that is making bread properly and pastry properly, they would advertise their croissants as croissant au levain, L-E-V-A-I-N, a levain, which is the French word for the mother culture. And historically, all croissants were made with a mother culture because it gives it that lovely, slightly sour depth of flavour. These days, most croissants are made with instant yeast, so you've lost that flavour base. So I teach my students how to go back and make croissants with the mother culture, with their sourdough.
Is that at that class for $500?
It is absolutely.
Excellent. Well done. Okay, now we need to go to an extra. Will you come back and do the third course?
Of course I will.
We're going to stop drinking.
Oh, really?
Well,
what, for now? Until for the next course?
Oh, no, for now. Okay, now, hopefully we're ready for our next award, which is, have you got anything for us, Amy, up there?
Just wanted to let you know that the bids are really going up. We got one of our Ken Duncan photos, but not the other one. So there's still one up for grabs, but well done on the 2,000 for the first one.
Excellent. Now, there are two Port Douglases, one right at the very top and one right down the very bottom. So if you're missing on one, have a crack at the other one. So that's all good. And now to our main award of the evening, our Pat Weldon Humanitarian Award. To present this award, please welcome Roger Langley, the chair of our Board of Directors.
Good evening and welcome. Every year, Children First Foundation recognises the outstanding services of an individual or organisation who has gone above and beyond in their commitment to improving the lives of children in developing countries, whether that be with their work in Australia or overseas. We're proud to announce this year's recipient, Associate Professor Leo Donnan. Associate Professor Donnan is an orthopaedic surgeon who's had a very long and close association with the Foundation since 2007. He has performed over 50 pro bono surgeries on our children in those 13 years. He's a passionate clinician who undertakes some of the most challenging clinical cases, both with Australian children and our children from developing countries. Where other surgeons have said no to difficult cases, Leo usually finds a way which he can make it work. His vast experience includes working in the UK and Siberia. He was appointed Chief of Surgery at the Royal Children's Hospital in 2006 and completed a Master's of Surgical Education to support the ongoing training of physicians and surgeons. He actively continues his research, which is now focused on health technology innovation to enhance patient care and clinical decision making. You may remember some of the children who Leo has treated and whose lives have been changed forever, not just by his dedication and incredible skill, but by his humanity in making them feel special and loved. Sarah, Alma, Daniel, Coco, Ilona, Edward, Trophy and Coney from PNG, Kashmala from Pakistan, Ali and Motaz from Palestine, Dorcas, Innocent and Rachel from Zambia, Celestina from Timor-Leste, Christina from Tanzania and Thierry from Madagascar. Tonight, on behalf of the board, the staff and the children we care for, we're very proud to award you the Pat Weldon Humanitarian Award. Congratulations.
Well, Roger, thank you for those very kind words, and thank you to you and the board who saw fit to award me with this amazing honour. It's particularly touching for me as it's been named after Pat, who was a very important part of Children First when I first started with the group, having been introduced to the services that you guys provide and how you care for children by my friend and colleague Ian Terode. This is not just about the things that I do. It's really important to understand that this is about everybody. There's so many people involved, from those that work out on the farm, people who stay and look after the kids overnight, who bring them in and out of appointments, who give them pastoral care, teach them, nurture them and take them through those really tough times that we cause from our surgery. It's a fantastic honour to be involved, to look after them and to watch the growth and development of children who we ostensibly come together to look after their physical needs, but invariably have a very big impact on them as people and as maturing young adults into adulthood. I've loved being able to do this work. I love working with the group of people that who care. The hospitals have been amazing in what they've given and handed over without any thought for what it might cost or what it might involve for them. Our nursing staff in hospital, the anaesthetists that work with me, who at a drop of a hat say, "How can we help?" It's a fantastic thing to be able to do, and I'm very privileged to be in this position and to have the opportunity to work with such a wonderful group of people. Thank you. I'm incredibly humbled. I am very touched, and I'm very proud to be involved with this organisation and hope that I can continue doing this for many years to come. But my real aim is to bring a number of other surgeons who are like-minded and have sort of the same skill set that we can give to these children and help them become better people, both physically, mentally, and to become the leaders in their communities in the future. This is what it's about. This is the important thing about helping children become adults that are strong, healthy, and have a greater life experience. And hopefully we can continue to do this. Thank you to everybody. I'm very, very touched.
Now, if we were at the venue, the place would have gone ballistic. So I'm sure you have at home what a wonderful recipient, absolutely, Associate Professor Donnan is. And clearly, these guys make such a difference. There's a couple of words I learnt during the year, and that was I think it was a basketball coach called his people difference makers. And that's that's these people that have been working for us. That's these people doing it for free. And that's you guys out there that are the difference makers that are helping all this happen for these children. So it's absolutely brilliant that it's all happened. And we're so grateful for Associate Professor Donnan and Professor Tran. So thank you to them. And yes, we're all clapping again. Now, more entertainment coming your way. You haven't seen nothing yet. You've had Amalia twice. Now we are going to bring the kids your way. So Stevie, I'm sure you're going to bring the kids on very shortly.
Sometimes it seems like I'm coming undone. This one can melt and feel lonely. No matter what, until this race is won, I will stand my ground where hope can be found. I will stand my ground where hope can be found. Questioning why, I will stand my ground where hope can be found. I will stand my ground where hope can be found. Oh Lord, I know you hear my cry. Your love is lifting me above all the lies. No matter what I face this, I know in time you'll take all that.
Back. Unbelievable. And once again, you would all be cheering and clapping, and here we are in the studio. But that's just the life we live at the minute, folks. It's all good. So I'm just going to grab Elizabeth back up here for a second, if I can. We're all... It's very COVID-friendly here, but it's all good. Now,
Elizabeth, Elizabeth, Mum would have been very proud of that. Elizabeth, hi, Mum.
That's all good. So... as I said, become a difference maker. Now, you've got some news or a challenge?
Yes, we've just received a text from Falcon Engineering to say that they will donate $5,000 for a night in ICU if a ballroom guest out there matches them. So on the site, we need a quick $5,000 from a wonderful donor, and Amy will see that coming up, and then John will very kindly throw in another $5,000. So that's two more nights in ICU. And little Sam Nang from Cambodia, when I think about him, he was in hospital on Christmas Day last year, and a few days after that in ICU at Monash Children's Hospital. So we've got a few other kids who are going to need ICU. If anyone can match John's very, very generous donation, we'd love you.
That's not this John.
Oh, no,
it's
no,
a different
no.
John. I will be killed. No, it's all good. Well, you never know. So that's just wonderful. The kids were great.
Yeah.
I mean, they're just fantastic.
Yeah, they're pretty special.
So we need to... Now, don't forget, you guys are getting away with murder tonight because normally I sell you nothing. And we get like lots of money we get over $5,000 for nothing. So you guys are getting away with murder. So you need to do this. We need to get someone to pop in another $5,000. We'll let you know when it happens, and then John will just match it. Then we're nearly there. So we're well over 30. Amy, where are we up to? Yep, 32.
Nearly up to 32,000.
Plus
yes.
Our 15 earlier.
Plus the 15. 40,
so we've nearly got these kids covered.
Yep.
Well, one of them.
One.
So, which is, we weren't sure how this would work, but it's working very well. And I just keep drinking. That's all I'm saying. Drink responsibly. You're not driving anywhere, but drink responsibly.
And remember, the auction is closing very, very shortly. So if you do want a raffle ticket or you'd like to make a bid on one of the silent auction items, we need you to jump on straight away, please. And one other thing, we'd love to see you all in your ball gowns or your tracky dacks or your PJs, whatever you're wearing at home, through our hashtag, which is hashtag CFF Virtual Gala Ball. So post up those photos, videos, and we can share some fun.
Absolutely. That is a sensational idea. In their jammies.
In their jammies.
Oh, I love it.
Drinking Sangiovese. Sounds like a good Saturday night in to me.
Ooh, so very good. And then we'll go and watch the Cats versus the Brisbane Lions.
Go
that's,
Catters.
That's going to be very good. Now we have beer. So would you like to hold up the beer for us? We have beer, Jetty Road beer. There it is. Wonderful sponsors of ours, and we've got a voucher of theirs. So there's a $75 first person to give us another $100 on the other one. You can have a $75 voucher to here. But we're going to show you their video right now from the boys.
Good evening, all. Graham from Jetty Road Brewery here. We're really excited to be part of this awesome event. In your hamper, you'll find a Jetty Road Pale and a Jetty Road Draft. Pale is quite a tropical flavour, very sessionable, 4.8% alcohol. The draft, you'll find 4.4% alcohol, a little bit less, a traditional lager with a little bit of hops coming through to break through that European style beer. We hope you enjoy and enjoy the night. Thanks so much.
That was so quick it wasn't funny. Now, don't forget the auction is closing. We will give you a quick countdown, but the auction is closing very soon, so get those bids in. We need you to get them in straight away, and because we have no control over that, that's done by a company that goes whack. Normally, we would make it last forever. We have Tamara back, and we're going to try and get Stephen back on the line if we can for our third course, which is, I can't wait for this one. This is absolutely brilliant. Off you go.
So this is my favourite cheese. It's Chelsea Blue, so named because my beautiful son Reagan's favourite soccer team was Chelsea, and I wanted to have a cheese that had some relationship to Reagan. And so Chelsea are known as the Blues, so it made sense to name a blue cheese for him. So this is Chelsea Blue. It's a Stilton-style cheese. It's on the younger side of a Stilton, so it still has that really nice salty-sweet balance. So when you're cutting yours, you should notice that it's a little bit crumbly, but when you put it in your mouth, you get this fantastic, smooth sweetness. Now I'm going to give you some, John, so that you can have a taste.
Not that much.
Just a little bit. And I'll put some quince paste on it because you specifically commented on that before.
I did. Can I tell you a funny story?
Sure.
Because we've got a bit of time. So when I met my wife, I found out when we were sort of whatever you call it, courting, I found out that she liked blue cheese. I had no idea what blue cheese was. So I met her for lunch one day and we were just seeing each other. And I went into the butcher, and I said to him, "Can I have?" It was a deli butcher, and I said, "Can I have a? Do you have bread?" He said, "Yep, I need a blue cheese sandwich because I know she loves blue cheese." He said, "Okay," so he started. So,
I'm already worried.
So he cut a very thin slice. Said, "Oh no. Make it much thicker than that, mate. Come on, I'm showing off." So he went, "Really?" And I went, "Yeah, really. Put it in there." So this is a true story. So she ended up with a sandwich about this thick with blue cheese, and it was just truly something that I've never been forgiven for.
You're actually very lucky she married you.
Oh, I know. And 37 years later, we're still there. He's nearly... Oh, Stephen's... Yes, he's up and he's paused, but he's coming in. So I had to tell that story while we found him. And then we'll find out which...
Now we're going to need to
open this. Oh, the bubbles. I'll do that. Yes, I'll open the bubbles. While you talk some more about the cheese, while we find Stephen. He keeps coming and going, but we'll get there.
So the Stilton is a fantastic cheese, and hopefully you're enjoying it on the fruit and nut crackers that you got in your hamper, because they really are fantastic cheeses to have with a biscuit that's slightly sweet, so a little bit of fruit. But don't just reserve it for a cheese board. If you've got any left over today, crumbling it over a pizza or a pumpkin risotto or a salad of roasted vegetables is just fantastic. And what you get is this lovely flavour of salt hit, but with a little bit of sugar sweetness underneath and creaminess from the cheese. And the pear is here too, because Stilton Style Blues.
Anybody else that wants to join in on the 5,000, you're welcome to, because we've got our 15,000, which is absolutely sensational.
Fantastic.
Well done. Thank you, folks. Whoever did it, thank you very much. We love you very much.
Perfect timing.
Sorry,
champagne.
Continue.
That's okay. So I've lost my train of thought, but a Stilton-style cheese is fantastic with any pip fruit, so apples and pears, and typically the firmer and sweeter the fruit, the better it pairs with a salty cheese. So they make a really lovely combination. Thank you.
Thank you.
The beauty of having bubbles with a blue cheese, as Stephen's going to tell us, is that you get the bubbles and the acid in the wine will wash away the richness of the cheese. Hey, Stephen.
Hello. Good evening again.
Good evening.
So this is the sparkling wine. Obviously, Meth Champenoise, 100% traditional fermentation technique. Chardonnay, 100%, so Blanc de Blanc. From 20-year-old Chardonnay vine. So there are different champagne sparkling styles. Some are more Pinot Noir. Chardonnay, Pinot blends. We've experimented with over the years. Where we are at is on the northern face of the central highland. It's really almost massive in its climate and soils, granite soil. So it has a purity, a density, we think a finesse, that suits the Blanc de Blanc. So it's very refreshing. It's very heritage style. It was lovely talking with Tamara and sort of seeing the challenge of how it would go with a blue cheese, because obviously sparkling wine, champagne, you can drink from an aperitif style right through a meal and finish up with a lovely blue instead of, say, a one. So I think the complementarity of the blue with the taste and the bright, fresh, zesty, pensile style of this Blanc de Blanc. It had 18 months on yeast lee, so it's really just the beginning of its journey. It's a 2018 one, which was a very good, fine, dry vintage, not too warm, ideal for producing sparkling wine. So, we make sparkling Shiraz. There's obviously in Heath people expected a sparkling Shiraz, but this is something we feel in Southern Heath that we can lovely refresh champagne style.
Thank you, Stephen. That's absolutely fantastic, and we are tasting it here. All of us are having a little sip. It's lovely. Excellent.
And one of the other things to talk about with the blue cheese is a lot of people are scared by the idea of eating mould, actively eating mould. And so they come up at the farmers markets and they say, oh, you know, no, I don't like blue because I don't like mould. And the first thing I ask them is whether they have ever eaten a Brie or a Camembert. And they look at me and say, well, of course. And that's the same eating mould. It's just white instead of blue. So if anyone, and I'm sure our very well-travelled and well-informed participants tonight are enjoying blue cheese and brie and don't have that concern about eating mould. But the mould that is in this blue cheese comes from Roquefort in France, and where that mould actually comes from is in the caves around Roquefort. And there's a story as to where the blue cheese mould spores first came from. And so historically what happened in that part of France was that shepherds would shepherd their animals up the hill, up the mountains during a hot summer, so where it was cooler in the hills, and they would care for their animals up in the hills. And during the heat of the day, the shepherds would take their lunch, their bread, their cheese, and eat it in the cave where it was cool. And then in autumn, they would take their animals down to the barn, stay there in winter, and bring the animals up in spring. And what was believed to have happened was that a shepherd left a loaf of bread or the remnants of a loaf of bread in the cave in autumn, and when he came back in spring, it was blue. For some reason, he decided to eat it, liked the taste of it, and that's where Roquefort mold spores are believed to have actually come from. Now, there's some supposition that that's a bit of an urban myth, but all the research I've done evidences that that is where the blue mold comes from. So the Roquefort spores that we put in this Stilton actually do come from the Roquefort caves, and that still is where blue mold comes from.
Wow.
It's fascinating, isn't it?
And, and clearly, it doesn't work in sandwiches.
Oh, it does, but just a little bit.
But not,
just not sort of
not
4 centimetres thick.
No,
no, perhaps not.
No, not a
perhaps
slab. Not.
Now, if you've loved these cheeses and you want to buy them again, you can order them online. So if you go to boatshedcheese.com, you can order cheese and it can be delivered or mailed to you if you're not within the delivery area. So if you've loved them, and I hope you do, please support the new owners and order their cheese online.
Oh, yeah. You have been wonderful tonight. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Once again, and Stephen, we're drinking the wine. You can order online. Yes, you can order Stephen's wine online. Yes, just he's back.
Yeah, thank you. I agree with Tamara that there's a lovely fine intensity in this blue cheese that reminds me of Roquefort. And it's interesting, too, Brett, historically, was very famous, still very famous for sheep growing. So it's the sheep's milk origin, Roquefort, that gives a certain intensity and character, which is really appealing. And I think you've captured that somewhere in this cheese. As we all know, there are a whole blue cheese styles, Bleu de Bresse, and there's very good Australian and Tasmanian blue cheeses. But I think this cheese is particularly successful, and a lovely nutty and pure, clean character, which, as you say, washes very well with sparkling wine.
Thank you.
Thank you, Stephen. That's been fantastic. Even with our technical difficulties, we still pulled it off. Thank you so much.
Thank you. It's been an event to be part of, John. So thank you for the invitation to be to Children First and to Elizabeth. And seeing the presentation earlier by Tony Woodwin, it's an extraordinary and we wish you all every success.
Thank you so much.
Lovely to talk to you, Stephen.
And thank you, Tamara. And we will now go to our comedian, which, if you know this young man, he has performed at 16 Melbourne International Comedy Festivals. You'll know him from the popular Spicks and Specks. He's out there. Well, he gets a lot of them right. Hughesy, We Have a Problem. He's been on many, many TV shows. Please welcome to our wonderful gala ball, Dave O'Neill.
Hello, thank you, John, and it's Dave O'Neill here, comedian. No, it's not Katie Lang. I do look a bit like her, and it's great to be here for the Children First Foundation Virtual Ball Gala event, raising some good money. Very happy to be here. And look, I love looking at everyone's screens and John's very professional background. Me, I like to present just a plain white background. No distractions here. Look, I've been doing it. Bit of hoarding. There's toilet paper and Weet-Bix, lots of potato chips. And don't hoard, kids. That's the message from Dave O'Neill. But, you know, I've got Weet-Bix, I've got toilet paper, I've got both ends covered. And, look, I did a gig for Smith's Chips the other day and they gave me lots of chips. And they gave me some of these. They're oven-baked ones. Don't bother with those, kids. They're no good. No. That's like going to Luna Park and going on the merry-go-round. No good. Go on the Big Dipper. Yes. Get these ones. They gave me some of these. Seriously. Oh, now we're talking. Yeah. Get Mum and Dad to get you some of those. They're the best. Anyway, welcome. I'm a comedian for the event. I'll try and be funny. I'm here in my bunker, obviously. Dave O'Neill, Spicks and Specks 55 times. The project, Hughes Have a Problem. Just give me a bit of background stuff on me. Went to uni, went to university. Have a guess what degree I've got. Have a guess. Just yell it out. I'll try and hear. Arts. Yes, I did arts. Best 8 years of my life, my arts degree. And I went to La Trobe. That's Latin for can't get into Monash. And when I graduated, no graduation ceremony, just a minibus, picked me up, took me straight to Centrelink. Yeah. Stopped off at Red Rooster, not for food, but a career option. So isn't it good, though, that we've pivoted? I've pivoted. I'm normally a stand-up comedian. I'm sitting down in my bunker, and I'm talking to you via Zoom. And isn't Zoom a great thing? You know what? well, I just love seeing people's backgrounds. You know what I mean? I love it. I love the guy on the Zoom call. Normally a guy. And I did a Zoom call the other day, and a guy had a tropical beach in the background. I said, where are you, mate? Are you in Port Douglas? He goes, nah, I'm in Dandenong. Well, why do you have a photo of the mall or the market? The donut van? You know, youth throwing bottles or something. Mate, you're in Dandenong. And I love the one, my camera's broken. Your camera's not broken. Just show us your messy house. Okay, we don't care. We don't care. I did another one the other day with a woman from a very corporate environment. She was sitting in the most pristine house. It looked like something you see on a ABC building show, like Grand Designs. It looks something out of Grand Designs. And I said, is that a virtual background or is that your house? She goes, it's just my house. It's just my house. It was immaculate. Unbelievable. I know that if you turn the camera around, you would have seen a pile of washing. You would have seen a teenager in a towel brushing his teeth and possibly some kind of lab they've set up to pivot. Everyone's pivoting. I've pivoted. Apart from being a comedian, I've also had a job down in the city working at a motel doing a bit of quarantine security work. And, yeah, look at me. I don't know what it is. Women love a man in uniform. What can I say? People actually say I look a bit like Benny Hill. Who remembers Benny Hill? Oh, one of the village people. Yeah, you know, YMCA. Anyway, great job. Great side benefits. We won't go into it because there's children watching. But look, I am here in the bunker. And how are we enjoying wearing masks? I assume most people are from Melbourne or regional Victoria, as Steve Brax used to say. I love regional Victoria. Hello to anyone from Ballarat or Bendigo or Geelong or down the peninsula. I know there's people from the peninsula. And look, I mean, I love places like Ballarat. I went to Ballarat there before COVID, had a gig, had a few drinks admittedly, woke up on the main street. I said, how backwards is this joint? They said, this is Sovereign Hill. I got it. Okay. But look, our Premier Dan has said there are only two reasons why you don't have to wear a mask. Number one, if you're smoking, and number two, if you're jogging. Well, look at me, I'm quite overweight, quite large man. Went to Jenny Craig, I lost $350. Yeah, that was great. So I had a discussion with my wife. I said, well, I'm going to take up smoking. So I'm up to one pack a day now, and it's going well. Lost no weight. But look, I like to toe the line. I'm no rebel, so I'm going to wear a mask. But I made a special mask for smokers, and you can get these at daveoneill.net.au, I should say. Here we go. Check this out, kids. Hey! That's not a real cigarette, guys. Relax. That's not a real cigarette. That's fake. Now, problem with being a minor celebrity, as I said, I've been on Spicks and Specs, and it's coming back, too, next year, doing my hair. I don't get recognised anymore with a mask on. It's really annoying. And I was talking to one of my good friends. We won't name him. We'll just call him Sheezy. Sheezy, we have a problem. Well, they do have a problem, don't they? He was on The Masked Singer. They all got COVID. It's ironic. They're all wearing masks. I got to admit that when I saw Michael Bevan take his mask off, I went, oh, he doesn't look well. In fact, I watch that show with the kids. And when the celebrities would take their masks off, the kids want to know if they were wearing a second mask because I didn't know who any of them were. Who's that? I don't know. Anyway, they all got COVID. That's beside the point. But Hughesy has told me he doesn't get recognised either. I mean, he's more famous than me. He goes, I don't get recognised anymore. I don't get no free coffees. I got no free coffees. No girls want any selfies. So I made him a special mask. And I'm going to send it to him. And it says, yes, it's me, Hughesy. I'm right here. Yeah. We've got a problem. No one knows me. Anyone tuning in right now, they're going to say, wow, they've got Hughesy. How's it going, everybody? How's it going? I don't know why Hughesy speaks like that. Look, problem with wearing masks, apart from smelling your bad breath, etc., is I like to walk and eat. I'm a large man, apart from the smoking. So what I've done, I've made my own mask. And again, you can make this yourself at home, kids. A bit of a craft-a-noon with mum and dad, maybe. And check this out. So you can walk and eat. Put it on. Simple. Two hooks over here, and there you go. Look at that. Hey, hello, everyone. It's like a chicken feeder. Hello. Oh. It's exhausting, isn't it? It's exhausting. Tell you what, though, what else have I got? Oh, special guest. Kids, get ready, because you know who's living with me now? The Wuhan bat. The actual bat from... Hello, hello, kids. Hello, everyone. Hello, CFF. Wuhan. Aren't you the reason we've got this virus? And we're, no. The virus was caused by George Columbaris. George Columbaris? Well, I've tasted the virus, and it tastes a little bit like tzatziki. Wuhan, that's not very... Hey, would you like a song? Yeah, we'd love a song. My corona, when you're going to give it up? Get it up, get... That's not... I've heard that on the internet. That's not an original. No, okay, I'll get you another one. Wash, wash, wash. Wash your hands. Or dan, dan, dan. We'll send a police van. Oh, Wuhan, that's not very funny. Yeah, well, you know, I'm just starting out in comedy. I'm pivoting. So this is actually a wet market I'm running here. If anyone wants to drop by, we've got bats. We've got possums. Hey, 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 no eating the bats. No putting me on a barbecue. I've got a message. You got a message? Got a message for Donald Trump. You got a message from Donald Trump? What is that? Stay positive. Get it? Because he's like positive with the... Yeah, I get it. Off you go. All right, there he goes. Wuhan kids. Hang on a sec. What? You've got... I got a present. You got a present? You got a present for Donald Trump? Yeah, here it is. It's another virus. Oh, Wuhan. So good to have you in my house. Yeah, so drop by if you're looking for anything in the wet market. Problem is, being a Victorian, is that everyone... You know, I've got a brother in Queensland. He's going to the footy. He's going to the beach. He went to Port Douglas for a holiday. God, it's annoying, isn't it? But you know what you've got to do? You've got to do what I do. I've got this here. Look at this. Who remembers this when they're a kid? The Kellogg's Variety Pack. That's right. We used to get all the little boxes. And which one did we always want? Cocoa Pops. Yeah. Kids, again, buy them at the supermarket, online, wherever. Now, these all represent the states of Australia. Currently, that's Queensland. Cocoa Pops, they're having a great time, they're partying on. Look at that monkey. Nutri-Grain, that's Perth, they're outdoors, they're on the go. Cornflakes, that's Adelaide, because it's a bit 1970, a bit boring. And that's us, we're Special K. No one wants us. That's Victoria, last in the box. Sad, isn't it? Sultana brand, that's Sydney, because every time you go there, it gives you the, makes you want to go to the toilet. So there we go, kids, get a variety pack and tell your friends, we are Special K at the moment. That's Victoria. No one wants this. Tell you what, though, it is fun, isn't it, doing Zoom meetings? Oh, I mean, put up your hands if you're homeschooling at the moment. Hopefully all the kids have gone back by now. But, oh, my God, since March, I've had three kids out that door homeschooling, one at primary school, two in high school. Three kids on the computer. I don't even know what they're doing. I'm pretty sure the 11-year-old's selling arms on the dark web. I have no idea. You got three kids in one room on computers, and then one pops up, they need help. The next one, can you help me with the algebra? The next one, my Zoom's not working. It's like whack-a-mole in my house, just putting out fires constantly. But my wife said that I was in charge of maths. You could have been in charge of maths. I said, hey, I only saw the first series, all right? If we're going to do The Bachelor, I'm all over that. No, she said maths. Oh, maths. No, I'm not that good at maths. She said, but aren't you a qualified teacher? I said, I am actually a qualified teacher. Apart from arts, I have a primary school teaching diploma. I could be teaching your children. And I said, but I finished my degree, my teaching diploma, in 1985. Let's just repeat that, everyone. 1985. And I never taught. And so I said to my wife, if I'm going to teach those kids, I'm going to teach it 1985 style. So computers are out, they're gone, unless it's a Commodore 64. And I've been smoking a lot in the staff room. That's all I've been doing. Smoking a lot in the staff. Remember that one? This will shock anyone under 40, but teachers used to smoke. Well, in the classroom they used to smoke. Then they banned that in the 80s. And then they could still smoke in the staff room. And you'd knock on the staff room door, like I went to Mitcham High, open it up at recess. It was like gorillas in the mist in there. Everyone's just like puffing on. Have you seen Miss Johnson? We can't find her in the haze. Or Benson and Hedges. It's terrible. But I tell you what, speaking of other 80s things, check this out. Look what I found in my junk room. Okay, this will freak anyone under. They won't know what this is, but all of us in my age group. Yeah, brashes. Now, this is a history lesson now for kids. This is a record shop from a record shop. What's a record, Dad? A record is how we used to buy music before we used to download it for free. You had to pay for it, and it was produced in black vinyl discs called records. What? I'll show you one, kids. Don't worry. We all wanted to work at Brash's, but they only employed good-looking girls, and so I never got a job. This is a 12-inch of a great song, Boom Boom by Paula Carcass. Boom Boom, Come Back to My Room. obviously for study purposes. Look, I know there's people on the peninsula. This would have been big, 21st century. The 21st century nightclub, I used to go there, and it had, what did it have that made it more special than any other place? The revolving dance floor. And only the girls used to dance, because, you know, it was Frankston, and it's a bit like a chicken rotisserie. All the girls were going in circles, and all the guys sat on the side. Oh, that one. Oh, for the younger people, a sushi train, you could say it was like. We had one at Stage One Disco and Manhattan Hotel as well. There were a few revolving discos around the place. Okay. Great song. I'm sure the people my age group would remember it. I mean, how old do you think I am? How old? Just yell it out. We yell it out. 40? 50? I'm 55. I know, I don't look. People say, what's your secret? So it's being fat or hides the wrinkles. Oh, that must be Botox. No, this is Gravox and heaps of it. All right. Boom Boom by Paula Carcass. Come back to my room. Now, obviously, he's Greek, Paula Carcass. He's under 30, so he's still be living at home, definitely. Come back to my room. That's Nonna. That's Mum. That's Con, my brother. Come, not the good room. In my room. Into the bunk bed. Yep. Okay. And we'll do our study there. Boom, boom. Come back to my room. What else can I show you? Here. What is this, kids? Ask your parents what this is. This is a landline. Because, kids, my generation, we grew up with phones that had cords on it. And as my son goes, how do you take photos when the phone had a cord on it? Well, we had these things called cameras. Remember cameras? I mean, some of you guys older than me, sir, you might have had the Sovereign Hill one where you just hold that thing and it goes, pa-foom, and you get your one photo a year. But no, we had cameras. And believe it or not, when my mother took a photo, she didn't take a photo of herself. She turned the camera around and took photos of everyone else. Unbelievable. But are we enjoying this new world of Zoom? We're not, really. And Zoom meetings are annoying, aren't they? I mean, this is great that CFF put this together. This is fun. But the average Zoom meeting for your company, whether you're a teacher or an engineer or whatever, a nurse, is kind of annoying. The same things happen at every Zoom meeting. Would you like me to do? I will do the average Zoom meeting, okay? We'll call it the CFF Zoom meeting. Here we go. Welcome to the CFF annual meeting, Zoom meeting. Gary, we can't hear you, mate. You got to hit mute. You got to unmute yourself. It's down the bottom of the left. Unmute yourself, mate. Unmute. Yeah, unmute. We can't hear you, mate. Oh, there you are. Okay, now the figures for this year. Look, now Lindsay should really be across. Is Lindsay here? Where is? I can't see Lindsay. Is that Lindsay there? No, he's over there. No. Oh, Lindsay, put your camera on, mate. Oh, he's on the toilet. Okay, we don't need to see that, mate. Anyway, look, the figures this year are... What's that noise? Is someone calling from a kitchen? What is that noise? Guys, stop making that noise. We've got the Zoom meeting here. Okay, and so you're into... My internet's bad. My internet... Was I frozen then? I was frozen. Anyway, we better get back to the... What was that? Oh, guys, stop mucking around. We've got stuff to do here. Oh, boy. Okay, meeting closed. Aren't they fun, those Zoom meetings? Well, me and Wuhan have to go. That's right, we got to go. We got things to do. But we'd like to thank everyone at Children First Foundation for doing a great job and all you guys for supporting it. Look, if you've liked me, I've been Dave O'Neill. And if you haven't liked me, I've been Dave Hughes. Wuhan, get away from the camera. All right, I'll just... We hit this button to turn off. That went pretty well. You went very funny. Shut up, Wuhan. Be nice.
Dave O'Neill, sensation. Now, once again, we would all be clapping and going ballistic. He was a funny man. I'm seriously... I wonder if he's not got a future as a ventriloquist. I'm pretty sure we could see his lips moving. But that's all right. Now, we're going to bring Tamara back because we have... We know that you can still donate because people are still donating, but you have a little sweetener at the end besides your cooking class.
Yes, I actually think the cheese making class has gone to somebody.
Has it?
But there is a fantastic seafood voucher from Peninsula Fresh Seafood for $120 platter. And I think I don't know how you're going to manage who it's going to, but it's there waiting for the next person that pledges. I think it was going to be a night in ICU. Can they still pledge?
I believe so.
$5,000?
I don't know.
That's a lot.
How about the next... 99. I think there was a $1,000 night in
there. There was.
Yeah.
Let's do that. Next person they get that seafood platter, which is absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, so that and that'll sort of, you know, be something that you can enjoy long after the pain of paying for the donation has been felt.
With all the wine. And thank you so much for being here with us tonight and your beautiful cheeses and all of your advice. No blue cheese thick in sandwiches. Thank you for that. But it has been sensational. We will sit down here for the next 3 or 4 minutes and probably knock that off.
Lovely. But it's been a pleasure.
Oh, thanks for coming.
It's always a pleasure. It's such a great cause. And, you know, anything that you can do to help for a cause like this, particularly at such a difficult time when it's so hard to raise money. There's a lot of people behind the scenes that have put a lot of time and effort into it. And, it, you know, for those of us that can be here and do it, it's a pleasure.
Fantastic. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
We're all clapping in the room. Thanks,
John.
Now we're going to bring back Elizabeth, or Liz. LL, are you ready? So we are going to... Here they are. Look at that.
Oh, hi, guys.
Hi, guys.
Hi. You all look so gorgeous. Wow. Oh, you having fun?
Yes.
Oh, gosh. We love you heaps. All these new friends you've made tonight. Wow. Okay, I have got the raffle winners. Would you like me to do that?
Well, let's keep them there.
And don't go, guys.
Don't go, guys. Stay there, Sonia. You stay there. We'll have a chat to you in a minute.
Okay.
Good.
Good. It's working. It's working.
Don't freeze.
Don't tempt it. Okay. All right. I am delighted to let you know that fifth prize went to Fiona Clark. Fourth prize went to Jenny Szymanski, and I'm thinking that's the beautiful rug. Third prize, Jan Maple, which is the beautiful painting. And Natasha Wright is the very lucky recipient, Rachel. Oh, she's gone. Of the portrait or the sketch of your home, Natasha, directly from our beautiful Rachel. So you can commission that. And Penny Trumbull, you're going to be the belle of the ball in the beautiful $3,000 bracelet from Kosminski. So, pardon me, many, many thanks for everyone who bought raffle tickets. Okay. Still me, I look at JS. And we're on time, so he might be able to watch his cats win tonight. All right, over to me. I have the great pleasure of doing the thank yous. Firstly, to my very, very dear friend JS. We're JS and LL to each other. Not just for being our MC tonight, mate, but you're a very dear friend of the children and the foundation. And John truly believes in our kids. He just doesn't do this. Some of you may not be aware that John is an OAM, and he's very humble, and he doesn't like us heralding that. But John was awarded that wonderful honour because of the amazing charity work he does, raising over $7 million for wonderful foundations like ours. And John is a great dreamer, and he dared to dream with us about this virtual gala ball. A few people said, "What on earth are you thinking?" And I gave JS a call, and he said, "Let's do it. Let's do it, LL. I'll get back to you." 5 minutes later, I get a phone call. We're good. RPPV, the radio station in Mornington that we're currently coming to you from, we've got them on board. And Steve, who you haven't seen, he's been running around. What was it, like a chook without a head? I can't remember what you said. Steve has pulled tonight together, and with the support of Brendan, we've got Luke, who is behind the video camera at the moment and smiling sweetly at me. Thank you so much, Luke. And Luke also put the kids' video together for us. and Amy, who works with JS on breakfast radios called Scrambled Eggs every Wednesday and Thursday. So Amy's been helping us out. So thank you so much, Amy, JS, and Luke, Steve over behind me in the booth, and Brendan, the manager of the station. I'd also like to thank Professor Ton Tran. And just before I do, Ton, I would like to apologise to you and for all our ballroom guests out there. We had a little technical hiccup at this end, and unfortunately Ton's beautiful, inspirational video got cut short. So we will send that full presentation through to all our guests tonight. There's a beautiful story of little Chien from Vietnam, and if it wasn't for Ton, Chien would still be carried to school, but now he's walking to school for the very first time. And when we do send you that presentation, you'll see a very proud little fella with his school backpack on, and he's walking. And that would not have happened without our wonderful Professor Ton Tran. To Leo Donnan, our Pat Weldon Humanitarian Award recipient, who, as Roger said, has performed over 50 surgeries since 2007. And Leo cares really deeply about our children and foundation. So thank you, Leo, and congratulations. And Pat would be very, very chuffed. To all the other compassionate and skilled surgeons and their surgical teams, there are so many of you out there, medical practitioners, nurses, allied health volunteers who partner with us, the hospitals who partner with us and provide humanitarian beds. We simply could not do it without you all. And how about Amalia? What an extraordinary gift she has. Thank you, Amalia, for sharing your wonderful talent with us again with those two beautiful songs. And Dave O'Neill, I think, to all my colleagues out there, I think Dave's been spying on our Zoom meetings, all except that toilet bit, I can tell you, Dave. But everything else was very much a CFF meeting. And sadly, I do remember brushes, plastic bags, vinyl records inside. I don't think I had a boom boom mum, I can assure you. Lady Southey, Stephen Shelmerdine and the Shelmerdine Wine Company. You may not be aware, but Lady Southey, Stephen and their wine company donated all the wines for tonight's ball. And they've been long-term generous supporters of the foundation. And we are just incredibly grateful to you all. And apologies to Stephen for that little hiccup during first course. And Tamara Newing, Stephen as our winemaker, Tamara as our cheesemaker, brought our three courses to you in our way of replicating a live ball. And Tamara just didn't just share her extraordinary stories and insights, but also a very emotional, touching story, Tamara, about how it all began for you, and the challenges that you as a family have faced. And we at Children First Foundation know all about challenges. So our sincere thanks. And also, Tamara also coordinated all the hampers for us. So we thank you most sincerely for that too. And our wonderful friends at Boatshed Cheeses, thank you so much. Grant and the Jetty Road Boys, I have a feeling that some of your beers were well consumed before tonight, Grant. I know of a few offenders, but I won't dob you in, my sons-in-law. Then those beautiful hampers, all those goodies, that was regional producers primarily from down here in the Mornington Peninsula, as well as the wonderful Shelmerdine wines from the Heathcote region. Dr. Sue English is one of our directors. Sue worked tirelessly with Tamara to coordinate the goodies for the hamper, plus all the packing and all the distributing they did. And Sue also arranged many of the prizes. So thank you, Sue, most sincerely. And it was Sue's husband, John. Thank you, John, who threw in that amazing challenge of the $5,000 ICU night, which we got. So thank you, John, very much. The happy band of packers down at Tramana on Tuesday were Chris, Lisa, Karen, Catherine, Karen and Penelope. Thank you so much. I hear you had a lot of fun and potentially devoured some of the cheeses and wines once the deed was done. To the wonderful ladies of the Children First Foundation Events Committee, who knows what our events will be like in 2021? But hey, we'll take on any challenge, won't we? Kathy Grant and the team at GDJ, our amazingly creative designers, they're our platinum partners. And Kathy and Russ have been friends of the foundation for over 15 years. I'm nearly finished, sorry, but tonight just we couldn't have pulled it off without all these people. And that was also Simon and Emma from Gala Fundraising, who, with their technical support and their awesome online platform that Amy has been driving tonight, we are very close. We might have some great news shortly to raising our target tonight. There were lots of folks, lots of organisations who donated raffle prizes and auction items. And it's tough. It's really tough out there at the moment for small business people. But your generosity and your kindness is extraordinary. So thank you for giving these kids a really, really wonderful gift. To my team, the Children First Foundation team, our team, brilliantly led by Trieza and Sarika. All the staff, the directors, our volunteers, and our extraordinary kids up at the retreat, who we hope are still there because I talk too much. They tell me that all the time. You can keep in touch with all these kids via our Facebook page and Instagram. And don't forget that hashtag CFF Virtual Gala Ball to share all those pictures back at home. And finally, a big shout out to you. We dreamt, we believed, but we knew we couldn't do this without having guests in the ballroom. And you took a plunge with us, and we're really, really grateful. We hope you had as much fun as we had. We did have fun, didn't we? We did have fun as we're all running around like headless chooks, but it has been fun, and we pulled it off, and we've raised an amazing sum of money. So to all you people in the ballroom out there, welcome to the Children First Foundation family. And thank you most sincerely for giving small lives big hope. We'll see you at next year's ball. Thank you.
Would be a rousing lot of applause there, Liz, if we had 500 people, it would be wonderful. Now, kids, are you still there? Can you hear us?
Yes.
Okay. Sonia, where's Sonia? That always happens. Why does that always happen? Dave O'Neill predicted it. But that's okay. So the kids are going to all wave and say goodbye and say thank you so much to you all. They're back? No, they're not. They were nearly back. So we need to let you know. Do you want to come and do this, Liz? Let's come and talk about the money, because when we started this, we went, we've no idea. Is it going to work? Is it not going to work? And seriously, we have had a few technical difficulties, so please forgive us for that, because there is only literally one, two, three, four, five of us in here, and it has been. That would be normally a team of like 10 or 12. So we've actually done extremely well. So the kids are back. Kids are back in town.
Have we got
the boys are back in town? That's a good song.
Yep, we've played that one before. Very, very close.
Where are they?
At the retreat, hopefully. They haven't done a runner on us, have they?
Yes.
Oh, you're back. Hi, guys. Sonia.
Hi.
Okay, Sonia, come on down. Have you got some news for us?
Have you got news?
Yes.
Off you go.
The final total of the amount is 64,851.
Woo! We did it. We did it, JS. We did it. We did it, guys.
Thanks, kids.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
See you later. Party on. Don't drink all the wine till I get up there.
No, please, no. Don't do that.
I'm joking.
So thank you for allowing RPPV, RPPFM to host this for you. I know you were excited to come here. We were so excited to have you. And thank you to Brendan, our station manager, who just said, whatever you want, just do it.
Yeah.
And that's just absolutely fantastic. For the Mornington Peninsula, we have been here for them all the time, our Brekkie show each week. We go local every week, but you can listen to us anywhere on our app. And thank you so much for all that you did tonight. And it's just been... We actually don't know how it's been. All we've seen is a screen telling us how much I made. But we think you've had fun, and even with a few technical difficulties. But thank you so much. Hopefully we'll see you at a venue next year.
Yes, yes. And until we do, sleep soundly tonight, because we hit our target and you have enabled Children First Foundation to change the life of a young person and give them one heck of a second chance of a happier, healthier life, full of hope back home. So our sincere thanks.
Thank you and good night. We're done.